Memorial Baptist Church. It's so good to be here to celebrate you with you on this, your men's day, your, let me get the year right. What is this, 68 years. Amen, amen. Come on, let's give God some praise. Let's give God some praise. And as my friend, Reverend Doctor, Don Owen said, it is, we go way back. As I was thinking, and just thinking about some of the things with your pastor had much mouth when we played. And it's not surprising to me that today he's a pastor. Because he had the gift again. He always thought he could beat me. He didn't always beat me, but he did sometimes. But I am not surprised that he is the man of God that he is today, that God called him into the ministry, that God is blessing his life, and that he is here blessing so many lives. Come on, let's give your pastor a hand of praise. Let's give him some praise for all that he has done and all that the Lord continues. And come on, you can do better than that. You can do better than that. Amen, amen. Amen. I am honored to be here. I'm honored to be his friend. I'm honored to just be in the midst tonight to celebrate this Men's Day. It is great when men and women come together to celebrate. And to celebrate. So let's celebrate. We celebrate the men tonight, but we invite the women to come in and celebrate with us, because we know we need you all. We need us all together celebrating and rejoicing in the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
I got some people that have come with me. I just want to thank God for my Latter Rain Christian Fellowship family for being with us today. To the Myers, the Reverend Stacy Myers and Minister Robin Myers for coming out. Amen. For two of the sisters that's coming out, Sister Roberta and Sister Robin, thank you so much for being with us today. Amen, amen. And to my dream, thank you to my wife for being here, for celebrating with us. But before I get to her, before I follow up with her, my daughters are here. Oh my God. You don't know, it's something when your children come out. Come on, let's be real. My daughters are here, Brianna and Shayna. Thank you guys, love you guys, Daddy, love you. Thank you for being my chauffeur today and driving us, Brianna. And to my beautiful wife, thank you for always being there for me, for celebrating as we come to celebrate this day. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for this privilege to come into this place, oh God, to bless your name and to give you glory. We thank you for the amazing and wonderful things you have done on our behalf. Not because of our goodness, but because you have been so faithful, our God. For you have given us, oh God, everything that we need. I thank you for this privilege, oh God, to stand before your people, to stand here on this Men's Day in this house of worship, this house of fellowship, stewardship, oh God. Thank you for this pastor and the first family, the leadership of this great church, and for all the men and women of Glover Memorial Baptist Church. Lord, I thank you. Oh God, as I stand before your people, God, I pray that you would hide me behind the cross, that you, oh God, would send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy, and I will be sure to give your name, and your name only, the glory, the honor, and the praise, and I ask all these blessings in the mighty name of Jesus we pray, and let all God's people say amen, 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 amen. I have come with a word for the house tonight, and I just want you to turn in your Bibles to Joshua chapter 5. Joshua chapter 5. And I do not know if this is your custom here, but we stand in Latter Rain Christian Fellowship for the reading of the word. And I'm sure you stand for the reading of God's holy word. Today, I will be reading from the New Living Translation. But you can follow along in your Bible. If your Bible says Bible on it, you would go right with me. Amen?
Amen.
Amen, amen. Joshua chapter 5, jump down to the 8th verse, and I'm going to read the 8th to the 12th verse of Joshua chapter 5. And here begins the reading of God's holy word. And after all the males had been circumcised, they rested in the camp until they were healed. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "Today I have rolled away the shame of your slavery in Egypt, so that the place has been called Gilgal to this day. While the Israelites was camped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, they celebrated Passover on the evening of the 14th day of the first month. The very day they began to eat unleavened bread and roasted grain harvested from the land, no manna appeared on that day, on the day they first ate from the crops of the land, and it was never seen again. So from that time on, the Israelites ate from the crops of Canaan. So far, the scripture. I want you to turn to your neighbor before you take your seat and tell your neighbor, greater is coming. Greater is coming. Amen. Amen. Greater is coming. As we celebrate this Men's Day, I just stopped by for a few minutes to let you know God is about to change your season. And you're about to walk into greater, into the promises of God. I don't know where you are right now. I don't know if you're ready for greater. I got, but I know I'm ready for greater. I'm ready for greater anointing, greater blessing, greater, oh God, favor from the Lord. Do I have anyone here this afternoon ready for greater from the Lord? Ready to receive more from the Lord? Sometimes God has to shift in your life because we become comfortable in one season. We become so comfortable, and maybe we miss out on what God has for us in our next season of our life because we become so comfortable with where we are. And this happens so much in church. Our God, we get so comfortable. We get stuck with just being good. With just being good. When we miss out on the greater that God has for us, we miss out on the greater. We want to be a good church. Our God, we want to be a good pastor. We want to be good Christians. And we miss out on the greater that God has for you. But not realizing God wants more for you. God wants more for you. Glover, I want you to know God wants more for you. God's not interested in you just being good. God wants you to be great. God wants you to be greater. He wants you to be greater than you've ever been before.
Amen.
And truth be told, and if we be truthful with ourselves, it is easier to move from something that is negative. It is easier. If something is negative, we can jump to the next one. But what happens when God wants to move you from good to greater? Right. What happens when God wants to move you from something that is good to something that is greater? That is the challenge we have. We get excited and we enjoy where we are. But if truth be told, you haven't seen the best that God has for you yet. You haven't seen what God is about to do. That greater is coming. Don't get so excited with where you are now, because God has more for you. And don't you miss out on God's ultimate goal of what he wants to do in your life.
Amen.
See, that's the content of our text today, this afternoon, found in Joshua. Joshua is the book of transition. It is a book of transition, a book of shift. Oh, God. See, we all know the story of Joshua. Joshua came after Moses, where God was moving the children of Israel into their greater. Moving them into the promised land. Moving them through the wilderness. Moving them to where God had them to go. God didn't just want them to get out of Egypt, but he wanted them to bring them into the promised land. He wanted to bring them into greater. He wanted to bring them into something that was better than what they ever had before. Our God. And the children of Israel had spent 40 years in the wilderness. And they wandered around for these 40 years because of their disobedience. Because they was disobedient. They missed out on the promises of God for 40 years because they did not believe that God has something greater in store for them. That God has something more for them. All right, you need to tell your neighbor, don't you miss out on greater. God has more in store for you. Don't you miss out on the greater that God's about to do in your life. Don't you miss out on what God is trying to do.
Amen.
And the book of Joshua starts with a shift, a change of leadership, a change, oh God. Now Joshua, not Moses, is leading the people. And the same anointing that was on Moses is now found on Joshua. Our God. The same anointing on him. Our God. Different mind. mindset, different skill set. But the same way God blessed Moses is the same way God is blessing Joshua. Oh God. It's the same way. And Joshua 1 and 2 is about a shift. And God using a woman by the name of Rahab to prepare the children for the promise. And Joshua 3 and 4 is about them crossing the Jordan River. It's about them going through the Jordan River. And we jump to chapter 6. And it's when the walls come tumbling down. And we can shout in chapter 6. We can shout to the Lord because the walls have come down. But when you look at all that God did for the children of Israel in chapter 1, 2, 3, and 6, you can tell God has something greater in store for them. You can tell that God has something more for them, oh God. But we have to know that the most pivotal chapter in this Joshua journey is the development of their success, which takes place in chapter 5. It is here in this chapter where the enemies of Israel, begin to believe that God is blessing them, and God is leading them, and God is guiding and providing for them. And now the enemies are terrified. They're afraid of Israel. They're afraid of what's taking place. And when you look at this chapter from a military standpoint, you can see this is the prime season to attack the children of Israel. It is the prime season, just like what we are going through now with this pandemic, separated, isolated. This is the prime season for the enemy to attack the church. This is the prime season for the enemy to come in and try to divide and separate. Look at what happens in chapter 5. The biggest problem for Israel isn't their enemies. It's not their enemies who was on their back. But it is Israel itself. It is the people of Israel itself. See, we spend a whole lot of time, blaming our neighbors, blaming our enemies, blaming our haters. We spend a whole lot of time doing the blame game, blaming someone else for our imperfections, blaming someone else for our shortcomings. But how many of you know your biggest problem is not your enemy, but it may be your enemy. It may be what's inside of you. It may be what you're going through. It may be how you're dealing with things and how you see it. It may be yourself. Is there anyone here who can be honest and say, when you look back over your life, you should have been further in the Lord than where you are now? When you look back, can you be honest with yourself and say, you should have been further in your walk with the Lord? But sometimes there was something that stopped you. There was something that blocked you. And truth be told, it wasn't your haters. It wasn't those hating against you. It wasn't your enemies. But sometimes we get in our own ways. We get in our own ways. We block ourselves. We block ourselves and we stop ourselves. That's what chapter 5 is talking about. It is so important for us today to know that God is trying to move you. He's trying to do a shift to make you more progressive, oh God. More progressive in your ways. More progressive in your thought, oh God. More progressive in your worship, oh God. He's trying to shift you from good to great. He's trying to do a shift in you. You've been good long enough. God is ready to move you to greater. Greater is coming. Greater is coming. Who's ready for the greater that God's about to do?
Amen.
And the only thing that can stop you, the only thing that can stop you from getting to your greater is you. Is you. See, what is our text telling us today? As we shift from good to greater, we must check, oh God, where we are going. We must check ourselves. We must check to progress to the greater. We must check ourselves. And I just want to give you 3 points today of things that you have to check. If we're going to embrace this greater that God has for us, if we're going to walk into the greater, there's some things that you're going to have to do. There's some things that you're going to have to change. And the first thing you need to do, and the first thing I want you to know, is you are going to have to make a shift. You have to learn how to check your flesh. Oh, you have to learn how to check your flesh. It's right here in the eighth verse. God tells Joshua, before you start yelling at those walls, before you start causing them to come down, I need you to check your flesh. I need you to check your flesh. God says, take all the men in the camp and circumcise them. Why would God stop in the middle and ask them to do something like this, to circumcise, to cut away flesh, to cut away something? It is what God did to Abraham and told Abraham. It's part of the Abrahamic covenant. God told Abraham to prove your righteousness in relationship with me. I need you to have all the men circumcised. All the men. Why would God think it's so important to cut away excess flesh? Because the people had to reproduce. The people had to grow. And it is too, and when there is too much flesh in the way, when there is too much self in the way, it will hinder your ability to grow. It will hinder your ability to reproduce, oh God. God says, I need you to get rid of some excess flesh. I need you, oh God, to get rid of the thing that is hindering you from growing, oh God. God knows if you're going to grow, you have to deal with our flesh first. You got to deal with your selfishness. You got to deal with what you are going through. You got to deal with this flesh that you're walking in. See, circumcision is a private matter. You can't see if someone is circumcised because of the way they look. Why would God make this so important? Why would he make this such a big deal? Because God knows that there's going to be some problems if we don't deal with our flesh. That we can't grow and expand ourselves and to deal with all that God is about to do. If we can't move to the greater that God has for us, if we don't deal with our flesh. When you don't deal with your flesh, you will start affecting people. You will start, oh God, running people away. You will start chasing people away. If you don't deal with the flesh, it will affect you and cause problems. See, I realize we have a whole lot of people walking around in church infecting people, oh God. Infecting others, oh God. Oh God, checking others and doing all these things because they have not checked their flesh. They have not been cut, oh God. They have not been circumcised, oh God. See, the flesh needs to be cut. It needs to be cut. You need to cut the flesh. You need to fix yourself in this. Because when you don't cut your flesh, when you don't cut the flesh, when you don't check yourself, you are sensitive. You are sensitive because it is a ball of nerves. You can always tell someone who has not checked their flesh. You can always tell someone who is not, oh God, circumcised because they are sensitive. They are sensitive. You can tell. You can't deal with anything. You can't deal with it. Everything gets on their nerve. Everything bothers them, oh God. Everything is a problem. I don't like this. I don't like that. It's too cold. It's too hot. They start complaining. They have a complaining spirit. And that simply means you haven't dealt with your flesh yet. You haven't checked your flesh yet. Tell your neighbor, sometimes you gotta cut that flesh. Sometimes you gotta check that flesh. Sometimes you gotta check yourself to know that you don't wreck yourself. If God wants you to be all that he's called you to be, you need to check your flesh. You need to check your flesh and make sure that your flesh is checked. See, when God ordained circumcision, it was supposed to happen in the eighth day of the birth of a child. Let's be real. It was supposed to happen to young boys, to babies. But notice who Joshua has to circumcise. Grown men. Men, he had to perform surgery on grown men. People who were dealing, oh God, with grown men who were dealing with little children issues. Grown men who were dealing with issues that should have been handled a long time ago. Grown men who were still struggling in their growth, oh God. Grown men who were still letting their flesh speak before the Spirit spoke. Grown men. Maybe that's why some of us are struggling with stuff today. With stuff you should have dealt with a long time ago. Stuff you should have cleaned up a long time ago. And here you are today with your big old grown self. Still dealing with your flesh. Still dealing with your childish issues. Still dealing with issues that should have been handled a long time ago. My God. God wants you to know it's time for you to grow up. It's time for you to come. If God can't cut you, God can't trust you. If God can't cut you, God can't trust you. If your pastor can't check you, your pastor can't use you. And when God cuts me, I need some time, oh God, to heal. I need some time to heal. Oh God, some time. If you're going to be greater, the first thing you need to do is learn how to deal with your flesh. God says if you're going to be greater, if you're going to be the greater church that I need you to be, if I'm going to move you from good to greater, you need to know that you got to check your flesh. And here's the second thing he wants us to know from this text. We have to know God and learn how to deal with our minds. With our mind. The greatest battlefield we wrestle with is the battlefield of our mind.
Amen.
The battlefield of our mind. Verse 9 tells us, God tells Joshua, in order for them to move, I need them to go to a place called Gilgal. Uh-huh. Because I need them to deal with the guilt of their shame from being in Egypt. I find this text funny. Because by the time we reach this point in history, there are only two people left that even have a remembrance of Israel, Joshua and Caleb. And it's amazing that they are the only ones who have a firsthand experience, a knowledge of what it was to be in Egypt. So my question today is, why are these people dealing with the shame of Egypt from a season they never experienced? Why are they dealing with something that they never been through? God, why are we dealing with an issue that's something that we never experienced firsthand? But how, oh God, do we deal with this evil? We never dealt with this. We are dealing with a place we've never been. Maybe the guilt of doing what we do today. We pass the dysfunction down. We pass dysfunction down. We pass it down. Whatever we've been through, we expect others to go through. Whatever we dealt with, we think that others got to deal with. We need to stop telling people how it was back then and not know that it's going to be greater, oh God. We need to stop telling people what we've been through and how we dealt with it and think that that same spirit is going to be with them. Then we wonder why the next generation is so infected. We wonder why they are so dysfunctional. We wonder why they can't deal with stuff. Because we as adults, we as the grown men and women of God, we have passed on some of our dysfunctions. We have passed on some of the things that we went through. We have put so much pressure on the next generation. We're quick to tell them that they're like this or they're like that. We're quick to tell them we have become comfortable that with words, we have become comfortable with words that we put on the next generation. We have been comfortable. We have to be careful what we start to declare over this next generation. When we do that, the next thing you know, you got a whole generation of shameful people. A whole generation of people that never went through anything like we did, but we put the shame on them. We don't like them. We don't even know why people who don't even know why they are in shame in the first place. See, we got to be careful that we're not telling them that they're like their daddies. We got to be careful when they're telling them you're just like your mama. We got to be careful the stuff that we put on next generation. We got to be careful, oh God. We got to be careful when we say to them, you haven't been through anything yet. Oh God, you haven't been through it. You haven't dealt with anything yet. I know one thing. They dealt with stuff that we never had to deal with. They dealt with stuff that we didn't. None of us, I don't know, maybe there's somebody over 100 years old. None of us have gone through a pandemic. None of us have gone through a season like this before. These kids are dealing with things that we never dealt with. So we got to watch what we say. We got to watch what we put on them. We got to watch, oh God, what we say. We got to watch how we talk to the next generation. And here's the struggle. Why we can't connect with the next generation. Because we ain't dealt with our shame yet. We ain't dealt with some of the issues that we've been through. We ain't addressed some of the things that we have to fix. And we start to infect the next generation based on our own dysfunction. We got to be careful that we don't pass it on to them. We got to be careful that we don't put it on them, what we've been through. We got to be careful that we don't bring the shame of our past onto them. We got to be careful. But the question is, how can we be positive when I can't even be positive with myself? How can we be positive with someone when we can't be positive? How can we build up someone if we don't feel good about ourselves? How can we give their blessings in their life if we're not blessed in our own life? How can we do this? The church needs to start putting people in position, oh God, that keep passing stuff on that has nothing to do with the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Nothing to do with blessing, oh God, the people. Stop passing on things that have nothing to do with God's word. And we wonder why the next generation can't exalt. We wonder why the next generation don't praise God. We wonder why the next generation is not doing all that we need them to do, or we think we need them to do. Why they can't build? Because they haven't seen, you haven't seen yourself correctly. So how can you help others? If God's going to move us to greater, beloved, if God's going to move us, we got to deal with our flesh.
Amen.
We got to deal with our flesh. If God's going to move us to greater, we got to deal with our minds. We got to deal with our minds. We got to stop putting stuff on other people. And the last thing, if God's going to move us to greater, we have to deal with our appetite. We have to deal with our appetite.
All right.
See, the flesh is important. The mind is important. But your appetite is what's crucial. It's what's needed. It's what's needed. On the plains of Gilgal, they go through the Passover. They celebrate the Passover. This is the third Passover for the children of Israel. The first time was when they left Egypt. The second time was when Moses came back with the Ten Commandments. And now in the Valley of Jericho, they are celebrating the Passover. And God is about to bless them, and God is about to keep them and do a change and a shift in them, because God wants them to know that my covering is on you, that my covering is on me. Passover is about God's covering. It's about God's covering. I'm so glad the blood covers me. I'm so glad that the blood covers me. I'm so glad that his blood, oh God, washes away all my shame. I'm so glad. If there's anybody else here who's glad that you are covered by the blood of the Lamb, so glad that the blood has covered you, so glad that the blood has saved you, so glad that the blood has covered your mind, oh God, so glad that the blood of Jesus Christ has fixed you and saved you. See, the text tells us that they had the Passover. In the next day, the following day after the Passover, they ate unleavened bread and the grain from the promised land. And verse 12 tells us, says that when they ate from the promised land, God ceased the manna.
That's all right.
God stopped sending the manna. See, manna was a gift from God. Manna was what came down every morning. You didn't have to work for manna. You didn't have to do anything for manna. All you had to do was wake up and go out of your house, and every day, manna would be there before you. For 40 years, God provided manna for them. But now they are ready to move. Now they're ready to go into the promised land. Now they're ready for God to increase, oh God, their blessing. And God ceases the manna. He stops the manna. God says, I can't let you eat from where you're going, oh God, if you're still addicted to where you came from. I can't let you go into the promised land, oh God, still living on your past. I can't let you walk into the greater that I have for you if you still need me to breastfeed you, if you still need me to feed you, if you still need me to do for you. I need you to start doing for yourself. I need you to get an appetite for me. I need you to have an appetite for the Lord. I can't get you to your greater eating in your past. I can't get you to what God has for you living in your past. He's setting you up for your future. In order for me to set you up for your future, I got to get rid of some things that's keeping you in your past. I got to remove some things that's making you comfortable. I got to remove some things that's not letting you trust me even more. I got to remove some things. I have to cease manna so that your appetite, oh God, would be for the things of God. So that your appetite would be for God and everything that God has. So you would appreciate the promised land. That you would appreciate where I'm taking you. I know your past was good. I know, Glover, that God has blessed you in the past. But you need to say, Lord, I don't want to get stuck in the past. I don't want to get stuck where I've been. I want to go from good to greater. I want to go into my greater. And I know my greater is going to come when I start trusting you. My greater is going to come when I start leaning on you. My greater is going to come when I start believing that you are my God. And beside you, there is a God. Lord, I need you to bless me in my walk. I need you to bless me in my talk. I need you to bless me as I move, oh God, as I step from good into greater. As I step from my good into the greater that you have for me. I need you to bless me. I need you to order my steps, oh God. I'm about to step into the promised land. I'm about to step into my next area of my life. And Lord, I'm looking for the greater. I'm looking for the greater blessing. I'm looking for the greater anointing. I'm looking for the greater worship. God is looking for those men and women that are not afraid to give him praise. That's not afraid to say, Lord, here I am. Send me. Lord, here I am. Use me. I need some greater. I need some greater. He's taking us higher. He's taking us higher. Stop living in your past. Because God has greater for you.
Amen.
Stop living in the past because God wants to do for you even more. Get a taste for your future. Get an appetite for your future because greater is coming. Greater is coming. Oh God, greater is coming. Pastor Odom, greater is coming. Greater is coming to the men and women of God. Greater is coming. Our God, greater is coming. You haven't seen your best yet. You haven't seen all that God has you. I want you to know greater is coming. See, the manna was good for a while. But you're about to walk into greater. Greater joy. Greater peace. Greater power from God. Yes, the Lord has been good to you. But he's got greater for you. He's got greater for you. I don't know who's ready for the greater. If you're ready for the greater, you need to stand on your feet and say, Lord, I'm tired of the good. I'm ready for the greater. Oh God, I thank you for the good times. I thank you for the blessing, oh God. But Lord, I'm ready to walk into my greater. I'm ready to walk into the promised land. I'm ready to walk into my future. I'm ready, oh God, to check my flesh. I'm ready to check my mind. I'm ready to get a greater appetite for you, Lord. As I go after you, I'm chasing after you, Lord. And I'm not going to stop chasing you until I get all that you have for me. You need to shout. You need to take 30 seconds right now and shout, oh God. Shout on your future. Shout on your greater. Shout on your blessing. Greater joy. Greater praise. Greater worship. Come on and give God a greater praise. You have to believe that God shift in your life.
Amen.
Good won't do it anymore. God has greater for you. You've been good long enough. You've been good and comfortable long enough. God is about to do a shift in you to greater. And with greater comes greater responsibility. With greater comes greater accountability. You can't be at home on Sunday. You can't be at home on Tuesday for Bible study. You have to be in the house. For God to move you from good to greater, you got to be connected. You got to be connected. You got to be connected with your flesh. You got to be connected with your mind. And you have to be connected with your appetite for the Lord. You cannot separate the three. Check your flesh. Check your mind. Check your mouth. Watch the things that you're putting on others. And walk in what God has called you to do. And increase your appetite. How do you increase your appetite? Reading the Word of God. Studying the Word of God. Going after the things of God. God is ready to do a shift. Good won't do anymore. Oh God. I hear the Lord saying to you tonight, good won't do any good anymore. It's time to shift to greater. Greater. God has greater for you. You haven't seen your best days yet. Greater is coming. And all He wants you to do is walk into it. The land has been prepared. The fields have been plowed. Oh God, God has laid down the word. Now, all you have to do is walk in it.